Hey, everybody. Welcome to Sama, Seattle, sacred music and art and all types of stuff like that. I'm Derek Mazzoni, your host. Thank you for being here. Hope you're doing well. And if you're not, I hope that changes soon. It's been hot, obviously, throughout most of the world. Climate change is real, my friends. But some interesting things are coming out, musically speaking. And I have a special guest here today. His name is Mike Steller. He's a friend of mine from Lisbon. We've known each other for quite a while. He came through years and years ago to Seattle as part of the Red Bull Music Academy. And he was our gracious host last time we were at Womex in Porto. We spent some time in Lisbon. And we were there to check the place out, get used to jet lag. And it was my first time in Lisbon. And it was a beautiful opportunity to reconnect and learn about what's going on in life. He gave us some great vinyl. Not just me and John. I'm not speaking in that weird way where I'm in the third person. But he was and offered a delicious meal. And he is doing some really phenomenal work in Lisbon. Womex is going to be in Lisbon this year. Yay, we're going to be there. And Mike has graciously offered to co-host with me and with Selma, who I interviewed before, to provide you more of these types of interviews and performances, which I'm really jazzed about. So as always, we have some music and performance and a DJ set for Mike, and then we're going to have a little conversation. So thank you for being here on Sama, Seattle Sacred Music and Art, with Mike Steller from Lisbon. Mike Steller, how are you?
Hi, Derek. Always nice to see you and to talk with you. Greetings from Lisbon and from a heavy touring around Europe. So plenty of music in my mind. So I think life is good at the moment with that.
What's been blowing your mind, musically speaking?
So I've been in festivals in Hungary and in Croatia and also in Austria. And I've came across some small projects, upcoming mixing beats and global sounds. Was this girl duo called Shambalisa, half Swedish, half German, half Hungarian? I was really surprised to see another Hungarian project called Deva, who mixes traditional Hungarian folk with electronics. Beautiful, with a four-piece band on stage. Was really nice to see that. Also, still in Portugal, there's this duo mixing Portuguese folk with electronica called Bandua, which I played a track on my mix for you recently. So these kind of things, I think the at the moment where I find more interesting music is in this fusion of tradition and modernity.
Why do you think that is? What's, like, you know, I have my own theories why this sound seems to be bubbling now.
A call to our ancestors. Also, if I speak more direct with the Portuguese folk projects doing this, I think it's a rediscovery of our roots under a new light, and that also brings it available to a new generation and makes them more curious about where this music is coming from, and this also might reconnect them with some of our roots and traditions, which I think are very important for us too.
I completely agree. That's exactly. I'm seeing this in other countries also, where it's like that Western imperial attitude, where not attitude, but just like people wanted to sound like they were Americans. They wanted to sound like they were from a different place. And now they are rediscovering their roots in their own particular style.
My generation grew up with a very strong Anglo-Saxon influence of music, and I wouldn't say we were ashamed of our roots, but it was not cool. Let's say that, you know, to listen to traditional popular music from your country is always an issue because, like I said, it was not cool. And when it started happening in other countries, and I think Goten Project had a very important influence in giving new clothes into a tradition like tango, and it showed people that it is possible to produce something modern but also filled with history and stories, you know.
Perfect. Thank you. When I visited you and when you gave me that mix for my show on KXP, I was blown away, you know, and it was one of my favorite mixes. I'm not just like, you know, going like, oh, Mike, we love you, but it was really, really sweet and really well put together and really well thought of. You guys, everybody out there, you should check out his Mixcloud, check out his SoundCloud. He does a really great job. But the thing that really was intriguing to me was that I didn't know the depth and complexity of just Portuguese music, Portuguese language, the various tribes that are there, and the you know, we people leave, they immigrate, and you have this one thing from that country. You just don't really know more. Like, example would be Spanish. There's a bunch of different Spanish languages in Catalan. Castilian is the language that came to South America and became the lingua of that particular region. But there's so much complexity in Portugal. There's so much complexity in the Iberian Peninsula, and you opened me up to that. I didn't know. You know, it's like being a global DJ, you're thinking about everything. But you gave me a sense of nuance, which I really, really loved, really appreciated. So thank you for that. Let's go back a little bit to your story. How did you get started? What's your origin story?
Origin as in the music scene?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, you could be an accountant. You know, you could be driving a bus. You could be president.
It happened a little bit by accident. I was a normal teenager listening to music from the tops, whatever was playing on MTV or other channels, until one day I was in a birthday party and someone played This Mortal Coil by track by This Mortal Coil called Song to the Siren, which is a Jeff Buckley original, and it just blew my mind, and I needed to find out what it was. Then I started by buying that record, and that opened me to the catalog of 4AD, which at the time was a really important independent English label.
Very, very.
Put me in touch with traditional music, because they had a release of the Mystery of the Bulgarian Voices. I don't know if you remember this polyphonic.
Bulgaria.
But at the same time, they were also releasing indie rock like Pixies, but also already some like electronic fusion. They released Pump Up the Volume by Mars. So it was a good label to open my mind to different sounds and influences. And then throughout the time, when I was studying sociology at the university, I got involved in the Students' Union, and I started organizing events there, starting with more grunge, independent rock stuff or alternative. But then in 1995, I discovered drum and bass and jungle, and I did the first big parties here in Lisbon, and it just caught me up, and I just started digging more into electronic music. And then I think around 99, I had a meeting with Michael Reinboth, the owner of Compost Records, who were starting this new jazz fusion in Europe. And quickly I started inviting people like Jazzanova, Rainer Truby, I just kept exploring things.
And here you are now.
You know, and here I am now. Then my work at Red Bull Music Academy, where I was for 15 years, was also eye-opening, because I actually managed to meet some of my music heroes on the several academies I've been present. And I've always kept doing my underground work, inviting unknown people I found interesting, introducing Portugal to people like Tony Allen, which I invited in 2002 or 2003, also Gilles Peterson, which had a very, very, very big influence on my music perspective. So I kept on throughout the years. I'm always curious about new sounds and fusion, and how to deal what I'm very UK influenced in terms of electronic music, because of my drum and bass jungle origin. So we call this thing hardcore continuum, which started with hardcore, then developing to the jungle drum and bass scene, then into the UK garage, then dubstep also comes out of that. So I've always been curious with that lineage of music, and also with a passion for Brazilian music led me to really enjoy world music. So when everything comes together, I really like music that is a melting pot.
Perfect. I agree. It's interesting because it came to you on the dance floor in one form or another. And that's a generational thing, where in the past it was concerts. You know, people discovered music through maybe radio. They still do, but they did then. Then it came through MTV, and DJ culture became quite big around that time period, obviously. And it hasn't stopped. It's actually gotten bigger and bigger. And, you know, you're talking about these bands that you discovered in Croatia and in Hungary. They're presenting their work still to the dance floor. There's another generation that's coming together, meeting and sharing this stuff. So, you know, I want to talk about two things in this space. I don't want to get too technical, but it's an interesting conversation, I think. What is it about the dance floor that does this? It feels like it's an ancient opportunity for the tribes to come together and share something.
It's a ritualistic moment, okay? It's a place of communion, of escapism, of transcendence also, you know? So everything is mixed there and put out there, and if you let yourself go, you will experience music in a completely different way. That's why I mentioned transcendence, because if you get on the dance, on the repetitive, on the letting yourself go, you will transcend yourself in that moment and go into a zone that it's your own, but at the same time you are sharing that moment with other people around you, you know? So it works both on the individual side, but also on the community side. And you can express yourself on the dance floor, which is really, really, really important.
Yeah, I agree. But it's also an interesting opportunity for you to discover, to have things revealed to you that you wouldn't really know. Like, there's something about a good set. And I'm not tooting the DJ horn, etc. But if somebody knows what they're doing, they can, you know, you can start mixing things from different places that has a resonance with the audience instead of just feeding them the same hits over and over again. You could take them someplace else.
Not only my kind of DJ and DJing, I also try to tell a story to people and bring them to someplace, you know? I am trying to express emotions to them, and then they do with that what they want, you know. But I'm putting myself out there in order to connect with them and to make them have some kind of experience. I don't try to impose anything, but when you're dealing with emotions, you are triggering things in people. So I see what I do more as a trigger to emotions in people, and then people just find their way, and I think it's still one of the places of freedom in the world. A dance floor, there is no class, there is no differentiation of class in a dance floor. You're just a human being dancing and expressing yourself. There, it doesn't matter where you come from, you know. So I think it's a really important place to be nurtured and to be kept free.
Yeah. No, I totally agree. But it doesn't have to be even a dance floor. It could be in a lounge. It could be in any kind of setting. Anytime somebody's putting together a thoughtful set, like, I have an intention behind this and I'd like to share this intention, I think it resonates with people. And it's an interesting time for this because you're dealing with algorithms right now. You're dealing with playlist culture, which in one form is awesome, you know, that everybody has access to everything. It's also kind of scary and sad that everybody has access to everything, because you lose stuff, you can't find it, you know, unless you have somebody out there like yourself going like, no, this and this and this and this are worthy of your time, because if you, you know, it will, the algorithm will not feed your soul. It might make you happy for a little bit, like listening to your favorite hits, and then after a while you're like, well, I'm not 17 and this music is fun, but it's not who I am right now, or it doesn't take me to where maybe I'd like to be, where I'd like to go.
You don't know. You need someone to guide you, you know? I always try to say that a good DJ gives people what they need, not what they want, you know?
Yeah.
So
yeah,
that's
a really
important part of our job, that we are presenting something that they don't know, but at the same time we are transmitting something that resonates in them and makes them react some way. It can be through dancing, it can be through just lying down and listening, it can be just as the background of a good conversation with someone you like, you know. So it can be in any kind of context. Actually, what you are saying just reminds me, in one of my sets this summer in Hungary, I was asked last minute to play in an ambient stage. It was really amazing, because it's very rare that you are allowed to play a proper ambient set. And what happened is that people started dancing to beatless music, and that for me was like wow. I was not expecting people just interpreting melody and noise and sounds without a particularly four to the floor beat, you know. And that's just like it made me remind that every music is danceable. It's just in your mind.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So we don't need the big banging beats to express and to express ourselves and to dance.
It's interesting, because you know, both you and I have been at this game for quite a while, and what we will play changes over time. You know, it's kind of sad to see a DJ that you like playing the same stuff over and over again. It's kind of like, okay, I mean, I get it, it's income, etc., do that. But even when they're playing at a set where you don't have to do this, you know, you've got enough of a rep to actually experiment more, they don't have the courage to do that. So the ones that do have that courage, the ones that are willing to push the boundaries a bit, I look for and I applaud and I try to champion them. But I myself personally, I've been finding that some of the more hardcore traditional stuff, where it's not syncopated, or you know, it's analog, they're creating rhythm patterns live, and just recording these field recordings, there's something really powerful there that isn't made by the machine. I love the machine. The machine is great. You know, it's like I grew up with it. But there's something that's going on there with some of these recordings that feels a little different. And even when you're seeing artists from, you know, from different parts of the world that don't have to go to New York or Berlin or Paris or London, but they're creating their own scene, they're creating their own vibe with the tools that they have. Laptops are relatively cheap right now. You can get a cracked version of Ableton or Fruity Loops. There's actually producers working on
global music. Is quite interesting, especially coming from more underdeveloped countries where they have more limited access to resources than in the first world, but they make something with it, and they are not following our rules, and they are working with their own limitations, and they are just bound by pure creativity, you know.
Yeah.
And that is what is bringing something that you don't expect, you know. And that's what is, for me, is interesting. Is when music surprises me.
And this is I kind of want to talk about this a little before we go, but like Lisbon is interesting because obviously you've got this lineage of Portuguese colonialization. You know, you've got Angola, Mozambique, Guinea, Brazil. You know, it's a small country that had Cabo Verde. You have these amazing sounds that are coming up right now that are all landing in Lisbon, where, you know, you've got obviously a huge tradition. You know, I just recently played Madre Deus. Request came in, and I was like, God, this band is amazing. I keep forgetting. And then you've got all of these new sounds coming in that are being created, you know, out of Luanda, out of Mozambique, that are coming here right now and are being kind of like recrafted or turned into their own thing. And this is really intriguing. This is one of the things that I'm really jazzed about, you and I and Selma exploring Lisbon and presenting that sound, because it feels like we're just getting the inklings of it. Like there's something that's going on there that combines a lot of this colonial history, but is making something for the 21st century, because it sounds raw. It doesn't sound polished, but once you play it on the floor, it creates magic. People lose it. So I'm really, really interested to see what you'll bring to the table with that.
I'll do my best.
And also the classics, you know, like, you know, you turn me on to a couple of artists that completely blew me away. Like, you know, the vocal quality. There's something about in Portugal, you know, the there's an emotion. And if you're a fan of Fado, the voice is so powerful and it has so much resonance. And I'm hearing that in other forms. And if you can combine those, the electronic, those different cultures, the historical colonial stuff, and then the actual tradition that's going on in Portugal, and something magical.
Okay, you have to understand that our revolution was not so long ago. So it was 1974. So it always takes a bit of time for a society to readjust and accept some values that on the first, I would say, 20, 30 years after the revolution were considered connected with the old regime, okay? Fado was one of those things, but also other styles of more traditional and folk stuff. So I think now we are in a period where finally we are growing up out, or we are growing out of that traumatic period that always happens after a big shakedown in our society, and now we can look at our roots without any kind of shame or trauma or any kind of problem, because the generations after 1974. Either they were from right-wing families or left-wing families, and that had a really strong relevance to the way you looked at culture, okay? And in this case, music, you know? So I think now finally, with the generation after me, with my son or a bit older in their 20s, they are playing with this with these sounds, with this music, without any connection to a recent past, okay? So that only makes it exciting, because we have a very rich tradition and we can finally play around with it.
Interesting. How does it play out? I don't start this conversation because it's politically loaded, so I'll just preface that. In the United States right now, you're dealing with a cultural awareness and an acknowledgement of systemic racism and an opportunity, trying to find opportunities to elevate, you know, African Americans, Latino culture, indigenous music, indigenous culture. And it plays out in an interesting way, you know, can you actually play this music? You know, we've had situations where people, because they look a certain way, they're judged. You know, it's ironic, but it happens. How does the colonial legacy and music play out? Does it play out like that in Portugal?
It's still an issue. It's still an unspoken issue, although more and more, I would say there is an awareness of that. But I would say it's too early still, okay? Because not only we went through a very long colonial war, so the generation of my parents still has those scars. But if we go a little bit back, we still haven't dealt with our role in the colonialism, on the slavery, and we had a strong and bad influence on that, okay? And our culture still not admits that. Here in Portugal, in schools, we are still taught that we were the good colonizers, you know? And that's bullshit, okay? So we still have to deal with that. We still have to admit our part in that in that shady business, okay? Of course, it has. I wouldn't say there is a positive side to something like this, but I would say that the richness of our culture also comes from a very early interconnection with other cultures. Okay, so we were traveling around the world in our boats, going to Asia, going to South America, to Africa, and of course that. That brings something back into the mainland. Let's say that I never forget. There's a painting from a Dutch painter that depicts one of our squares in the 18th century, and what it depicts is a multicultural society. On that picture, you see people from all races living here in Lisbon. You know, so I can imagine that mixture has left something, okay? We just have to regain that, but also at the same time rethink our position on how we think of ourselves in that process. We have to stop with the idea that we were the good guys, that the Spanish were way worse colonizers, we were as bad as them or any kind of colonizer, okay? So I think that's the next step here to overcome that, because in terms of using that multiculturality here in Lisbon, you already see it in the music, in the art scene. There is a bigger acceptance, and that brings creativity up.
Okay, that's good news. That's an interesting place to be as a DJ and as a selector, because you're doing that work in real time by what it is that you're putting out. And you know,
remember in the 90s to play, or in the early 2000s to play an Angolan track from Do World Negro or from Bonga was considered cheesy. You know, people would look at us, why are you playing this? This is not cool music. You know, and now they are like Bonga has had a very strong second part of his career here in Portugal. He was always big in France. Praise that, because that's what kept him going. But you're in Portugal now. Bonga is the coolest guy, you know. And in the 80s, 90s, and 2000s, he was considered a cheesy artist. Which is
It's an interesting how a next generation kind of comes in and looks at this as this amazing thing. You know, we both have kids, and you see this as like, wow, okay, you know, you like this, this is amazing. I'm seeing this with my daughters right now. They're like, oh, I love this, I want this. And and you know, but at the same time, we came up with the dance floor. They are their generation, the other generation. Dance floor isn't going away. The role of a DJ to actually present something isn't going away. It's becoming much more amplified, and the ability to actually produce something is interesting. You and I had this conversation about how many songs are uploaded to Spotify every day. That's expanding. Other platforms are expanding. TikTok is becoming really hyper important within pop music. There are all these other channels, but the opportunity of an actual organic person such as yourself making those choices, putting it out, that's just at the beginning of something, because there's a whole population out there that would want that, would want to see you, would want to hear you, would want to know something of you, and to be able to share that and share this legacy, that's a pretty amazing thing. This is one of the reasons I started Sama, and one of the reasons I've been at KXP for so long. It's like, this is making an impact, and I'm jazzed to have you along for the ride. Where are you next? I want to just, because this goes out very soon, I want to let people know where to find you and how to find you.
Here in Portugal, but in around a beautiful lake called, it's the festival is called Waking Life. And there's a very good program that mixes like strong electronic music, but also you can listen in the afternoon to Jimmy Tanner concert and other kinds of organic music. So it's a really, really, really well curated curated festival. And then I'll just keep on traveling. In September, I have some stuff in Croatia. I'm playing in this festival called Gulash Disco, which is really, really, really nice in one of the islands of Croatia. And then I'll keep on playing wherever I am asked to.
Perfect, perfect. Keep at it. Mike Stoller, thank you so much. I'll see you in a few weeks, and we're going to create some magic together. Everybody, thank you for supporting Sama. Please, please, please share, like, tell your friends. We're obviously on TikTok, Instagram. We're going to be on Discord relatively soon. We're on YouTube. We're on Twitch. And we're going to get more mixes from Mike Stoller. We're going to get more video. We'll be at Womix. We'll be in Poland after that, working with the Warsaw Village Band and a few others. Hopefully, inshallah, it happens, but I think it will. And we're going to be also, we're have a more guest hosts. And we've got a whole bunch of content. We have beautiful music from the Vancouver Folk Festival with some fabulous artists from Korea, from Finland, from Chile, and from India, and more. So peace, be well, and thank you for listening. Thank you for watching Sama.